welcome to The Book Was Better. We're watching today's movies one book at a time. And it's our 5th year anniversary! And we have something special for this year's review. Something I've been holding on to for years. Sir Thomas Malory's The Mort d'Arthur, celebrating the life of England's greatest king. The legend of King Arthur and the Knights of the Round Table have been around for centuries, with some stories originating more than a millennium ago. Now I could spend ages talking about the history of Arthur, his knights, what we know, what we don't, but just to save time, you should check out Overly Sarcastic Productions' video on the subject. La Morte d'Arthur is a large collection of stories about King Arthur's life, the accomplishments of his knights, and how he died, but it's hardly a totality. It's kind of like a buttload of loosely connected novellas, one of which is the excellent Tristram and Isolde. But that's not in today's movie, so whatever. So for the sake of not including what could be hundreds or thousands of tangents, I'm going to do my best to contain literary references to only what's within this one book, and not other Arthurian collections like that of Chrétien de Troyes or the Vulgate Cycle.
And may God have mercy on us all.
La Morte d'Arthur was published in 1485 and collected several stories about King Arthur and his Knights of Camelot. Strangely enough, while the book is credited to Sir Thomas Malory, we don't know exactly which Thomas Malory wrote it. It's suggested that there were 6 men sharing the name at the time that the book came out, but because the author gave himself the title Knight Prisoner, most scholars agree that our man was the son of John Malory of Warwickshire, which is just a fun place to say. And it's also believed that our Malory was kind of a piece of shit. It's believed that Malory wrote La Morte d'Arthur in prison. He was imprisoned in 1433 for multiple crimes, including robbing an alley, at least 2 counts of rape, and the attempted murder of the Duke of Buckingham. He was eventually pardoned by Henry VI, but wound up back in prison after attempting to overthrow Edward IV. It's this second prison visit that he's believed to have written the book. Malory died in 1471, with the book being published posthumously. But despite his criminal history, he is praised for inspiring many other authors and creators, including T.H. White and Lord Alfred Tennyson. And although it's indirectly connected, La Morte d'Arthur also helped lead to the greatest comedy movie of all time.
What is the airspeed velocity of an unladen swallow?
What do you mean? An African or European swallow?
Huh? I don't know that.
When knights around the table, we dance where we're able.
Enter John Boorman. He had penned a script for an Arthurian movie and attempted to adapt La Morte d'Arthur, but it would mean a 3-hour movie and no studio would spring for that. He was even offered to direct a Lord of the Rings movie, which he declined, but used those books as reference for eventual design choices. Instead, Boorman shopped around, directing other such classics as Exorcist II, The Heretic.
I was possessed by a demon. Oh, it's okay, he's gone.
Deliverance.
Come on, squeal!
And Zardoz.
The gun is good. The penis is evil.
Truly, this man was destined for greatness.
It's a busy life in Camelot.
I have to push the pramalot.
On second thoughts, let's not go to Camelot. It is a silly place.
Right. Is that right?
Any man who would be a knight would follow a king? Follow me!
Where are we going?
Boorman did eventually get his Arthurian movie made in 1981, but it was cut to 2 hours and 20 minutes. At least the casting was great. Nigel Terry was cast as Arthur, and with him were Helen Mirren, Nicol Williamson, Paul Jeffrey, Nicholas Clay, Liam Neeson, and Patrick Stewart. In fact, Excalibur is credited for helping launch Stewart's and Neeson's film careers. The movie also employed the legendary armorsmith Terry English to craft the armor, and love him or hate him, this is one of director Zack Snyder's favorite movies of all time. It's so significant to him that it's the movie a young Bruce Wayne saw with his parents the night they died in Batman v Superman. But La Morte d'Arthur is an extremely dense book. How can its multiple stories be unlocked in 140 minutes? Has the movie aged well in the nearly 40 years since it came out? And will Boorman include some really awkward sex thing? Not very, sort of, and yes. This is Excalibur, a big blockbuster bastardization. We open with a battle between the forces of Uther Pendragon and the Duke of Cornwall. And advising Uther is the wacky, lovable Merlin, going for maximum ham levels in his delivery.
The sword! You promised me the sword! And you shall have it. But the heel, not the hack. Tomorrow, a truce. We meet at the river. Talk! Talk is for lovers, Merlin! I need a sword to be king!
Merlin goes to a nearby lake the next day and retrieves Excalibur from the Lady of the Lake, and hands it to Uther shortly after.
Show the sword!
Yeah, that's cool, but I don't think the peasants are gonna like this.
Strange women lying in ponds distributing swords is no basis for a system of government!
But the crowd instantly recognizes Excalibur's divine presence, and the Duke of Cornwall yields to Uther's authority, once promised all the land from there to the sea.
Good. King Uther and his beast together! To my castle!
And they start the party off by cutting their wrists and pressing them together.
Ah! My wife will dance for us!
Because no party is complete without a softcore stripper dance.
You may be King Uther, but no queen of yours could ever match her.
And Uther actually agrees, much to the peace treaty's downfall.
I must have her, and risk everything you've won.
Well, we've been at peace for about 12 hours. Might as well go to war. So the war for Uther's erection begins, with Uther laying siege to the Duke's castle. But the defenses are too formidable, so Uther is forced to call upon Merlin once again.
Where have you been?
I have walked my way since the beginning of time. Sometimes I give, sometimes I take. It is mine to know which and where.
You must help me, Merlin.
Must I?
I am your king.
So, you need me again now that my truce is wrecked. Years to build and moments to ruin. And all for lust!
For Igraine!
Now, while Merlin is angered by Uther's actions, he does see a chance to profit in the long run.
Igraine. You will swear by your true kingship to grant me what I wish. Then you shall have it.
By Excalibur, I swear it.
What issues from your lust shall be mine. Swear it again.
I swear it!
You ever get so turned on that you agree to sell your son to some half-crazed wizard? Merlin leads Uther to a collection of stone pillars and begins to chant a spell.
Anal natrach Urfas befad Duhjeldin me
Anal natrach. This is called the Charm of Making, which was written in Old Irish. It was reconstructed by linguist Michael Everson, and the term loosely translates to
serpent's breath, charm of life and death, thy omen of making.
So after passing out to Merlin's droning, Uther wakes with a start.
I dreamt of the dragon.
I have awoken him. Can't you see all around you the dragon's breath?
But the Duke rides out with his army to attack Uther's forces while a mysterious fog covers the sea. Merlin explains that he will transform Uther into the Duke's likeness and that he should ride over the fog across the water.
But the cliff! The sea!
Your lust will hold you up. You will float on the dragon's breath. Ride! Ah!
Ah! Ah! So, boners are buoyant. So Uther makes it to Igraine's chamber, and this is where things get really uncomfortable.
Hush, Morgana, hush.
My father is dead.
Look, here's your father.
We'll talk more about Morgana later, but for now, can we just agree that it's really creepy to try to seduce a strange woman in front of her child?
Come, Igraine.
And then they fuck! Right in front of Morgana. Just not even gonna send her to hang out with a maid for the next 2 minutes. But wait! It gets worse! We get a softcore porno scene with a fully naked Igraine and an almost fully armored Uther. I don't think armor really worked that way, but even if it did, shouldn't that chafe something terrible? And oh god, you've got a lot of sensitive parts there. What if something got pinched? Plus, I don't imagine it feels good for Igraine if each thrust is backed by plate mail jamming into her crotch. But wait! It gets worse! The woman playing Igraine? Her name is Katrine Boorman. Yes, she is, in fact, the director's real-life daughter. He is filming her in a sex scene. Okay, it's not that bad because Gabriel Byrne, who played Uther, stated that the director wasn't even in the room when this particular scene was filmed, which was for the best. Can you imagine how mortifying it must be to perform like that in front of your dad? Sweetie, it doesn't really sound like you're having an orgasm. I need you to moan louder. So, the deed is done and Arthur is conceived.
The future has taken root in the present. It is done.
Uther leaves, and later the Duke is brought in and dropped right in front of his wife and daughter, complete with spearheads still embedded in his chest.
Oh, Morgana.
My god, lady, are you trying to give your kid a complex? Months pass and Arthur is born. Uther, having married Igraine since we last saw them, comes to check up on her.
Is it mine?
Now, this is where the movie alters a scene from the book. In the movie, Igraine admits that she doesn't know who the baby's father is, and Uther promises to raise him all the same. In the book, Uther admitted that he and Merlin use magic to be fair, Igraine does react with disgust in the movie when she learns the truth. And despite this, Igraine in the book was relieved to learn that the baby was Uther's and planned to raise the baby as a healthy prince, and swears to faithfully obey Uther's word, quote, as a dutiful wife should. And that screaming you're hearing is all the feminists swearing off this book for all time. Ah, but then Merlin returns to fulfill that pesky promise Uther made.
Merlin, you come when you're not asked, and pay no heed when I call you.
Oh, I have slept for 9 moons. What I did for you wasn't easy. Now you must pay me. The child is mine, Uther. You made an oath.
Uther relents at first, but then realizing the true cost of his promise, tracks Merlin down in the woods to get the baby back. He doesn't get far when he gets ambushed by one of the Duke's former knights. Uther is mortally wounded, but gets the last laugh when he plunges Excalibur into a nearby stone.
Nobody shall have the sword! Nobody shall wield Excalibur but me!
Uther then succumbs to his wounds, even though in the book he died of an illness and didn't pursue Merlin at all. But I guess death by combat is more cinematic than death by sniffles. The next time we see Arthur is after a long time skip. Arthur, now in his late teens, has been adopted by a good knight named Sir Ector, leading his son Kay and Arthur to a tournament.
Now remember, my sons, what I've told you, and pay no heed to these robber knights. You, Kay, be brave and honest and merciful, as a knight should be. And you, Arthur, be modest and true, and help your brother to uphold the good name of Morven.
The winner of this public tournament is deemed worthy of attempting to pull Excalibur from the stone. This is very common knowledge. Like, that's the only reason anyone's here. I just want to make that perfectly clear for what I think is the best line in the movie. We see some of the tournament as every knight forgets how to use a lance and mistake them for cudgels.
I remember my first joust. It looks far worse than it feels.
Most notably among them is Sir Londegrance, played by the immaculate Patrick Stewart. Just cold cocked a man off a horse. God, I love this movie. So Londegrance is granted permission to pull Excalibur from the stone.
By my right of victory, by my blood, give me the power.
Londegrance!
But of course, it doesn't work. Do you think Picard ever plays out this scene in the holodeck where he does pull out the sword?
Prepare and be ready! Who would scout for the right to draw the sword from the stone?
So the tournament continues.
Arthur, where's Kay's sword?
Arthur has forgotten Kay's sword and discovers it's been stolen. He runs around looking for it, passing a brief cameo by Terry English, but he can't catch up to the thief. But then he finds himself standing in front of Excalibur, the sole reason anyone is in these woods in the first place, and gives the best line in the entire damn movie.
Father, I'll go and see what's keeping you.
Well, hurry, you missed your chance.
Your sword was stolen, Kay. But here's Excalibur.
He has drawn the sword!
Oh, that is so lovably stupid. He just yanks a legendary sword out of a rock, which he has to know makes him king, and he so innocently thinks nothing of it. Then he just hands it over to Kay like it's nothing. Contrast this scene with the book. The sword that Arthur pulled out of the stone was not actually Excalibur, but was a sword that only the true king could pull. Excalibur came to Arthur through Merlin, who got it from the Lady of the Lake. As you can see, the movie just combined these two swords into one, probably to save time.
He's trying to foist a fatherless boy upon us! Do you want a bastard as a king?
Lord Leondegrance, join us against the boy!
I saw what I saw! The boy drew the sword. If a boy has been chosen, a boy shall be king!
No! I challenge that!
The sword has been drawn!
Arthur's unorthodox rise to power angers some of the local knights and lords, though Londegrance falls in line at once. Tensions rise, but Merlin takes Arthur aside for a small chat, albeit creepily and inside a dead patch of underbrush.
Merlin! Why have you done this to me?
Because you were born to be king.
What does it mean to be king?
You will be the land, and the land will be you. If you fail, the land will perish. As you thrive, the land will blossom.
But why?
Because you are king!
No!
A lot of this chat is to set up a separate theme in the movie than what the book said, which we will get to later. The scene also gives Arthur a chance to get some character development in.
Merlin, what kind of man was my father?
Oh, he was brave. He was strong. He was a great knight.
He literally went to war just to get laid. So Arthur comes across a few knights who are loyal to him, such as Sir Ector and Sir Kay. Since Londegrance is under siege, Arthur leads a raid to rescue him, which is of particular importance because Londegrance is Guinevere's father, which is accurate to the book. But the book took a different direction here. Since there was more of a religious aspect to the book than the movie, Arthur was chosen by God and all that, he was able to assume the throne with little doubt. So we didn't have the small forest scene with Merlin. Arthur did face some competition, but instead of countering a raid on a friendly knight, Arthur had to fend off a cabal of 11 different kings standing against him on a unified front. Fortunately, because Arthur was a good man chosen by God, he had plenty of knights, lords, and lesser kings flock to his side, which allowed him to come out on top.
In the name of God, St. Michael and St. George, I give you the right to bear arms and the power to meet justice.
That duty I will solemnly obey. As knight,
and king.
I never saw this.
Rise, King Arthur.
We cut forward a few years to Arthur and his knights attempting to cross a bridge, guarded by a talented knight.
None shall pass.
What?
None shall pass.
No, not him.
We have won battles against armies. Now one man defeats all my knights.
This knight is actually Sir Lancelot of the Lake, a skilled fighter wearing only the shiniest of armor, and was believed to have been the best knight. At least until his illegitimate son Sir Galahad surpassed him in the book as Top Gary Stew and God's favorite. But Galahad isn't in the movie, so whatever.
I am Lancelot of the Lake, from across the sea. And I have yet to find a king worthy of my sword.
That is a wild boast. You lack a knight's humility.
Not a boast, sir, but a curse.
Arthur and Lancelot fight, but Arthur has grown impatient and prideful in his brief time as king. This fight scene is one of the better ones in the movie, showing a more realistic take on what fighting in armor was like. Grappling, glancing blows, and even stiff movement were all shown, thanks in large part to the excellently crafted armor. We even see some elegant moves by Lancelot like half-swording. And Arthur shows how ineffective dual-wielding actually was. Unfortunately, I can't be as nice to all of the movie's fight scenes. While the fight with Lancelot looks like a realistic fight, others, like the introductory fight scene, feel more like a cheap stage production. Now, this isn't objectively wrong, but stylistically, it isn't my thing. It looks more like someone just filmed a play straight on, which I think looks rather off-putting in terms of cinematography.
Excalibur, I call on your power.
Merlin, what have I done?
You have broken what could not be broken.
While this event never occurred in the book, it does share a theme of a knight's humility.
My pride broke it. My rage broke it.
Knights were expected to uphold godly values, protect women and the innocent, and fight evil whenever they came across it. Since Arthur violated that ethical code, he gets punished by losing Excalibur, thus risking his kingdom and everything he worked for. His redemption comes quickly, though, when he admits that he was wrong. A quality which is all too rare these days.
This excellent knight, who fought with fairness and grace, was meant to win. I used Excalibur to change that verdict. I am nothing.
The scene plays out a little easily, including a deus ex machina, but thematically it does fit well and at about the same pace as a similar story from the book. So for a scene that was made up entirely for the movie, Boorman and his crew did a great job getting it right. A quick repentance from Arthur means the Lady of the Lake replaces the broken Excalibur, and Lancelot is so impressed with Arthur's skill in combat that he offers to join him. With his knights at his side, Arthur is soon able to unite most of the land.
Hereafter, so that we remember our bonds, we shall always come together in a circle to hear and tell of deeds good and brave. I will build a round table where this fellowship shall meet, and a hall about the table, and a castle about the hall.
And the land is at peace and all is well. Camelot is built, Arthur and Guinevere wed, and the land sees prosperity like never before. Arthur and his knights even get shinier new duds, armor which gleams like polished silver. Everything seems right in the world. The doors and hearts of Camelot were open to all, but that meant that Morgana Le Fay could enter as well. Now, Morgana was not the friendly sort that you might remember from the Magical Treehouse series. Morgana was a lot of different things depending upon your source. A powerful witch, Arthur's sister, and by some other stories, she was one of the fairy people, which is what Le Fay meant. She's even more in the movie, though, because she's an amalgamation of three different people, Morgan Le Fay, Morgause, and Nimue. The movie actually names her Morgana instead of Morgan, possibly to allude to this unification. Morgan is the main basis for the character of Morgana, and in the book, she often plotted against Arthur and Camelot. Morgause was Arthur's sister who tricked him, slept with him, and begat the young knight Mordred.
I have conceived a son, my king. My brother.
He'll be important later. Nimue was a young sorceress in training who studied under Merlin.
Mandrake. The essence of it can prolong the act of love.
And if too much is taken?
Pain and death. That's it.
Ooh, you do know something of the art.
She often spurned his sexual advances, then buried him alive in a cave when she got fed up with him. Which sounds considerably more effective than using the block button on your phone. Morgana was played by a young Helen Mirren, and she was chosen deliberately because of Nicole Williamson playing Merlin. The two actors apparently didn't get along in real life, stemming from a performance of Macbeth several years prior. Boorman thought that the tension between the two would add a flair of realism in their performances. There does seem to be a bit of unease in some scenes, but Merlin and Morgana mostly get along fine.
It's a lonely way, you know, the way of the necromancer. Yes. To know too much. Lacrimae mundi. The tears of the world.
But the power. The joy.
Moments. Fleeting moments.
I can ease your loneliness. Let me help you. Teach me.
The days of our kind are numbered.
Any apparent discomfort in their performances gets overlapped by Morgana's cunning and Merlin's hamminess. I guess that's what you get when you hire professional actors who can set aside their differences for the sake of the movie. Time passes, and Camelot becomes a shining beacon for the land. Everything is clean, festive, and healthy, yet Lancelot can't find the will to stay for long. The reason for that is because of his intense love for Guinevere. Aside from being a strong and valiant knight, Lancelot's affair with the queen is perhaps what he's most famous for. He personally saved Guinevere several times in the book, once from a rival king, and another time from Arthur himself after the affair became public. The movie goes in a significantly different direction than the book, but that's a discussion for the ending. In Lancelot's journeys, he came across a young ward who wants desperately to become a knight, and even offers to run the 20-day trip to Camelot alongside Lancelot if he must.
20 days? The world's not that big.
This precocious youth, played by a 26-year-old Paul Jeffrey, is Percival. You might recognize the name from Ready Player One, and that is not a coincidence. Percival was the original Grail Knight, tasked with finding the Holy Grail. That honor fell to Galahad and Lamorte to Arthur, so while Percival was still a vital warrior in the search for the Grail, he was not God's favorite Gary Stu. But more on that later. Peace reigns in Camelot, but Morgana starts whispering suspicions to an inebriated Sir Gawain, played by Liam Neeson.
He's our best and our bravest. Why then is he never here? Without Lancelot, this table is nothing. Is there anyone here who doesn't think of a god? And now to be driven from us by a woman's desire!
Arthur and Guinevere both take this as a tremendous insult, so much so that Arthur calls Gawain to combat against Lancelot to defend his claims.
I decree that at sunrise 2 days from now, the champions will meet and the truth shall be known. For by the Lord of God, no knight who is false can win in combat with one who is true.
This actually encapsulates the whole affair business very succinctly and fairly for all parties involved.
My laws must bind everyone, high and low, or they're not laws at all.
You are my husband.
I must be king first.
Arthur is bound by law to be the judge in the fight and can't defend Guinevere, despite how much they both want him to. Lancelot, however, does his best to avoid Guinevere, hence his aversion to Camelot, but can't deny how he feels.
Save me from myself. Purge me of this love, so that I can defend her.
Guinevere may love Arthur, but she's not getting the care or attention she wants from him, and she's also very attracted to Lancelot. This exemplifies the differing types of courtly love that we see in the book. Arthur is a good man who can't fulfill Guinevere's desire, and Lancelot is a good man who can't be with Guinevere despite them both wanting it because of the impact it would have on the kingdom. Now, I might be getting into the nitty-gritty of the affair as well as the history of courtly etiquette to the point where I might be losing some of you, so here's a non sequitur. Throughout the book, we see all of this, but we're never told who the guilty party is, or that there even is one. Everyone involved is human, and since they're not actually God himself, they're all flawed. The movie takes a different turn, though, and we are led to believe that Lancelot and Guinevere are guilty when Arthur discovers them in a field. But I'm getting ahead of myself. We got a fight to get to! The morning of the duel arrives, and Lancelot is nowhere to be seen. Gawain demands to fight someone so he can proclaim his honor, but none of the other knights want to step up and fight their brother in arms. That's when Percival walks in.
Let me champion the queen!
Since the squire can't fight a knight, Arthur promotes Percival to knight on the spot, without any real training, claim, or deed granting him the right, somewhat delegitimizing the idea of what it takes to be a knight in front of all of his men. Gotta admit though, Percival has balls. Jousting without armor? Kid's gonna die. Now, Percival was a full knight in his own right in the book, but given Lancelot's guidance over him, I think that Boorman just put Percival here in place of Sir Gareth, younger brother to Sir Gawain, whom Lancelot personally knighted. It was also Gareth's death that led to a full-on war between Gawain and Lancelot, which the movie runs out of time to show. Which sucks because that event and the battle against the Green Knight are pretty much the only notable things Gawain ever did. And wow, I have got to do a better job of managing these tangents. Lancelot arrives just in time to take over for Percival and fights Gawain, but doesn't win as handily as everyone would have guessed. In the night, he had a vivid dream and stabbed himself with a sword.
I fight against myself!
But he's able to grapple Gawain to the ground and gets him to yield.
I yield to your mercy, Lancelot. The queen is innocent!
But then Lancelot succumbs to his injuries and falls over. Later, Guinevere is so elated that Lancelot fought for her and survived the fight that she goes to him and they prove Gawain right the entire time by bonking in a field. The movie even plays a set of happy strings music just to solidify how in love these two are.
Do you still have the sight, Merlin? Are they together?
Yes.
You warned me of this. All those years ago. What must I do now? Kill them?
I can tell you nothing. My days are ended.
But Merlin has been getting increasingly pessimistic as of late. Part of that is because he has the sight and knows how and when he will die.
Will I see you again?
No. There are other worlds. This one is done with.
In some ways, there's something poetic about him accepting death, but then there's the matter of how he died. He got tricked.
Merlin, take me with you. The charm of making, you swore to pass it to me.
You think you're ready? Are you worthy?
I am. I am.
Then, follow.
If he were to fall in combat against an enemy he simply couldn't beat, like how Gandalf first appeared to fall to the Balrog, then that's one thing. But Merlin pretty much made and walked into this trap all on his own volition.
Sword, the land!
Yes, Merlin, that's it. Set the world to rights. Call the dragon. Mend the sword. Speak the charm of making.
Morgana tricks Merlin by learning the charm of making, then seals him inside a crystal, deep within a cave, effectively burying him alive. And this was a good visual twist on what they changed from the book. In the book, this plot was committed by Nimue, who wasn't overtly evil, like what Morgana is being here. And Merlin wasn't trapped in crystal, he was locked in a cave with a large boulder set in front. I actually prefer the movie's turn of events more, since Merlin was set as this wise, imposing figure, so it makes sense for him to fall to something with a more magical touch. Another change is in when this happened. For all the fame Merlin has enjoyed over the centuries, some readers might think he accomplished all sorts of feats and quests, but within Lamort d'Arthur, he actually gets buried alive within the first few chapters. Some traveling knights later hear him yelling within his cave, but since they also can't move the boulder blocking Merlin, they just press on and forget about him. But while we're on the subject of Merlin, can I just say how much I enjoyed Nicole Williamson's performance? Merlin comes off as all-knowing and wise, but also extremely campy. Merlin's performance has more ham in it than a bratwurst party served with a side of bacon.
It is everywhere. It is everything. Its scales glisten in the bark of trees. Its roar is heard in the wind, and its forked tongue strikes like...
Whoa, like lightning! Yes, that's it.
It doesn't exactly mesh with the other performances, who otherwise keep things down to earth, but it's not so distracting that it ruins the movie. I see it as a nice addition, something enjoyable that stands out against an otherwise decent experience. It's like getting a plain burger from a fast food joint with extra rich chocolate cake for dessert. So Guinevere and Lancelot go into hiding after Arthur discovers their affair, leaving Excalibur behind.
The king without a sword! The land without a king!
Yeah, that is a bad thing. Maybe I shouldn't have fucked his wife! Unfortunately, this, and Morgana's monster child, has a negative effect on both Arthur and the land.
Is he dead?
No, he lives.
Time passes, and the land has lost all its glory. Arthur has grown ill, and the citizens are forced to farm mud. Fortunately, Arthur has a solution.
We must find what was lost. The Grail. Only the Grail can restore leaf and flower. Search the land.
Find what was lost? So, you had the Grail? I suspect that this scene was affected by the 40 minutes of movie that Boorman was forced to cut. It's one of the more obvious moments because Arthur just comes out and says, "Hey, I'm missing my favorite cup!" No lead-up, no mention of the Grail previously, and most notably, no divine proclamation from God. This revelation is much darker and quite different from the book. There, the knights all saw a sign of the Grail revealed to them underneath a cloth. And from there, the knights all volunteered to go out and retrieve it, for glory, for their king, and for God. Also, Arthur wasn't dying or anything, so this was just a quest for the sake of being good Christian knights. While I do prefer the movie's necessity and purpose of the quest, the book had just so much more weight to it. The holy providence of it just seems so vital to fulfill, even if it was Galahad, God's favorite Gary Stu, leading the charge for a good portion of it. Still, it was a lot of fun reading about the intersecting paths the knights took to win the Grail. And even better, this section was all about shitting all over Lancelot for being an unrighteous man. It's what it gets for railing another man's wife! The Knights of the Round Table ride off in all directions searching for the Grail. Searching for more than a decade.
Have you found it? The Grail! It's me, Percival!
In that time, the land goes to ruin, knights die, and soon Percival is one of the few remaining of Arthur's knights. All hope seems lost.
We would never find it.
But again, this is much different than the book. While we see constant ruin and suffering in the movie, the book spared us such extreme images. It was basically an extra long camping trip in comparison. Percival sees his fellow knights fall on the quest, including Gawain being tied to a horse, dead.
Gawain.
Things don't get any better when he gets captured by the young Mordred, wearing the most gaudy armor I've ever seen.
You seek what Arthur wants? That thing they call the Grail?
I do.
Then follow me.
The kid looks like an old Doctor Who villain. In the book, Mordred was an accepted member of King Arthur's court as a fully fledged knight. He just betrayed Arthur and attempted a coup when Arthur left for France to confront Lancelot about the whole affair business. Mordred in the movie acts much more like some blatantly evil schemer hiding in the shadows. Mordred tricks Percival into following him, trying to sway him to the side of evil like he had done so many other knights.
here. Mallet, you too. You're alive.
There is no grail as these good knights have found. They serve me instead. There are many pleasures in the world, many cups to drink from, and they shall all be yours. Drink.
No! This scene, and the 10 years of suffering that the land has gone through, contrasts notably with the book. The book featured much more adventure and combat, while the movie is able to focus on keeping faith during hard times. And thematically speaking, this is kind of a one-sided compliment to the book's original religious themes, between that of paganism and Christianity. Red from Overly Sarcastic Productions put it best when she said that the religious ideas of Arthurian legend often intersect, but never clash, which definitely corresponds with Lord D'Arthur. That's because in many ways, when one idea is presented with a religious background, it doesn't overextend itself. Who is the Lady of the Lake and where does Excalibur come from? Where do Merlin and Morgan get their powers from? The book doesn't go into too much detail, but it's obvious that they're more of a mystical, natural kind of magic, like druids and fairy magic. But then why do the knights quest? Well, for glory and God, of course! So much of what they do, and their success, hinge on God's approval. Hell, the main reason why Lancelot failed to find the Grail, and why Percival, Galahad, and Bors were so successful, was because of their virginity. Lancelot had a few lovers, Guinevere most notably, and was constantly shamed for it on his quest. On the other hand, Percival and Galahad were both virgins, which was why they were both deemed worthy as Grail Knights. Bors was cool too, but he had a smudge on his record since he touched a boob once. Hell, Galahad was so pure that he died peacefully in service to God and ascended to heaven at the end of the quest. Again, God's favorite Gary Stew. And while I'm on the subject, one interesting way that these two themes intersected and actually complemented each other were in the prophets that guided the knight throughout the book. Old men and women would sometimes consult wayward knights and get them back on the right track, but these elders were usually hermits or religious leaders like abbots or priests. Although prophecy is hardly forbidden by the Bible, giving access to random hermits, instead of exclusively giving it to religious figures, seems to strike a balance between the two sides of paganism and Christianity. One doesn't necessarily need to follow God or his teachings in order to have some sort of insight. Or maybe I'm getting way too into this and I need to go soak my head.
Get on with it!
Yes! Get on with it!
Percival manages to escape Mordred's grasp, but he hits his lowest point when he witnesses Mordred murder a fellow knight. Percival's rock bottom is shown brilliantly in the state of his armor. And actually, all the armor makes for a great display of visual storytelling, which complements the state of the land and the knights themselves. Long-winded speech incoming. When we first see any knights at the beginning of the movie, they're all wearing dull iron armor. Effective, but tarnished and not very impressive. And this is reflective of the knight's behavior, like when we see them first joust, improperly using a lance and resorting to thuggish behavior. This changes when Arthur unifies the land. Suddenly, everyone has shiny, clean armor that glistens in the sunlight. This reflects the purity of the land and how happy the citizens all are. But when the land falls to ruin, that once shiny armor dulls and gets grimy or covered in dirt. But while Arthur and his knights suffered, Mordred and his army flourished. Mordred rides around in his golden armor, while his knights all get black armor. Mordred's armor is showy, but corrupting as gold often is, it signifies an unearned sense of glory. His knight's armor also signified darkness, of course, rounding out an impressive display by armorer Terry English. And one final note is that this armor was so impressive that it inspired mangaka Kentaro Mira when he created Berserk. Berserk is one of my favorite manga, and the level of detail that Mira puts into the armor is nothing short of obsessive. From the standard armor of the General Knights, to Griffith's armor as he leads the Band of the Hawk, to main character Guts donning the terrifying Berserker armor, this is definitely a series that you need to check out. No more tangents! Percival overhears the wails and cries of a nearby crowd and sees a familiar face leading them.
Look at the great night! Peace and plenty they promised. But what did they give us instead? Famine and pestilence!
Lancelot! Is it you?
Because of their pride! Because of their Lancelot!
Asshole, most of this is your fault! If Lancelot hadn't given in to temptation, Arthur wouldn't have lost Excalibur and the land wouldn't have rotted away. Morgana might have still beaten Merlin and begat Mordred, but the central reason for all the suffering in the land was for the loss of a sword. And now Lancelot is running around blaming others for his mistakes. I don't really like this incarnation of Lancelot. I was never a big fan of his in the first place, because of the affair business, but at least the book was able to handle him with a little more neutrality. This guy on screen is just a selfish ass. So Lancelot and his crowd savagely beat Percival and throw him into a river. A Christ-like quality there. Percival nearly drowns and has to shed his filthy armor, as if he's shedding sin, and emerges from the water in only a pair of pants. Again, rather Christ-like. And because of his trials and tribulations, Percival is shown the Grail, which is able to return to Arthur, and the movie takes so many left turns from the book that it's doing corkscrews in the parking lot! For starters, for all their efforts, the Grail never returned with Percival or Galahad to Camelot. In fact, both of them died at the end of the quest, though non-violently. The Grail returned to heaven as Galahad gave up his soul to God, where they probably spent their days bro-fisting. This scene is much more akin to what Chrétien de Troyes wrote, detailing Percival's account with the Fisher King. There, Percival traveled until he met an injured king, who invited him to stay at his castle. While there, Percival witnessed a procession of candles, a bloodied spear, and a grail, but because he had been trained not to ask too many questions, he didn't ask what was going on. He was admonished for this, because if he had asked who the grail served, he would have cured the injured king. The movie seems to have made Arthur the injured king as a stand-in, with the grail appearing before Percival again and asking him questions.
What is the secret of the grail? Who does it serve?
You, my lord.
Who am I?
You are my lord and king. You're Arthur.
And this all comes down to the little scene from the underbrush much earlier.
You and the land are one.
This whole the king and the land are one thing works, but it was made up whole cloth for the movie. It actually veers more towards a pagan theme when so much of the rest of the movie leans more to Christian themes. I like to think of it as Boorman just trying to balance the two religious themes in the book.
You and the land are one. Drink.
I'm wasting away, but I cannot die. I cannot live.
Drink from the chalice and you will be reborn in the land with you.
So the Grail heals Arthur and the land is restored, albeit in an awkward green screen effect. Arthur and his knights even get their shiny armor back. And swinging by a nunnery, Arthur finds Guinevere, who's living out her days as a nun, which is accurate to the book.
Accept my forgiveness, and put your heart to rest. We've suffered too long. I've always loved you, and I still love you.
I loved you as king, sometimes as husband. One cannot gaze too long at the sun.
Forgive me, my wife, if you can.
She even kept Excalibur safe all this time.
I never dared to hope all these years that it was in your keeping. I've often thought that we may meet, and you'll come to me and claim me yours.
With his army complete, Arthur leads his men to where Mordred and his forces are waiting, planning to rest up before the oncoming battle.
Arthur.
But Arthur's return to glory has stirred the hidden Merlin.
Arthur,
where have you been these many years? Is it true that Morgana's
stories? You brought me back. Your love brought me back. Back to where you are now, in the land of dreams.
Are you just a dream, Merlin?
A dream to some?
a nightmare to others!
Merlin didn't make another appearance after his imprisonment in the book, but he is able to slip through people's dreams in the movie. And he uses this opportunity to aid Arthur in his upcoming battle by taking out one key figure.
I have returned. Enchantress. Have you used up all the magic you stole from me to keep yourself so young? Have you any magic left to do battle with Merlin?
Merlin tricks Morgana into using the Charm of Making, which not only sets a heavy fog over Mordred's campsite, but uses up the rest of Morgana's magic, which turns her into a shriveled prune since her magic made her look younger.
Merlin, where are you? Where are you?
Mordred doesn't like this, though. So that's Morgana out of the picture, even though she doesn't die in the book. Quite the opposite, actually. She's one of the women who sailed Arthur to Avalon after the upcoming battle. Kind of a dramatic heel turn, but Mordred was a Knight of the Round Table in the book, so there are a few creative liberties in play here. Mordred's treason was actually a result of Lancelot's affair. After Mordred and another knight tried to ruin Lancelot and Guinevere's reputations by revealing the affair, Lancelot and a few knights loyal to him fled to France. Arthur followed with the rest of his knights, leaving Camelot underdefended. Mordred swooped in and proclaimed himself as the ruler, forcing Arthur to return and fight him. Not cool, Mordred. Crap like this is why Jon Snow is everyone's favorite bastard. So the fog has covered the battleground, and Mordred is on edge.
Where are they?
Listen! They will know how few we are in the fog!
We'll use the old ways. Speed of horse! Ha!
So we get a very staged fight scene that was probably incredibly dangerous to film. But as simple as it is, there are some exciting moments.
Kay! Percival!
Kay!
Arthur and his knights are surrounded, but before they can get overwhelmed, Lancelot shows up for an oddly placed redemption arc. So did he just stop blaming Arthur and his knights for the state of the land? Lancelot just runs in to save his former brothers with complete disregard to his previous scene, in which he beat Percival and threw him into a river. Maybe seeing the land flourishing again restored some of his senses, but that's only a guess.
Arthur! Arthur!
Lancelot eventually succumbs to his injuries when Arthur comes across him.
Lancelot.
My salvation is to die a Knight of the Round Table.
You are that, and much more. You are its greatest knight. You're what is best in men.
Banging other dudes' wives and creating a cataclysm that divides the land is the best thing that another... Forget it. Lancelot finally gives his last breath and dies on the battlefield. In the book, he fell into disgrace and retired as a monk, but maybe Boorman had a soft spot for him. But the battle isn't over. Mordred is still alive and is armed with a spear and a wicked stare.
No, Percival.
Come, Father. Let us embrace at last.
And Arthur just lets himself get stabbed. Like, he doesn't even try to deflect or anything, he just casually accepts a mortal wound. This is like when kids play with swords and die by tucking them under their armpits. But badass as he is, Arthur just steps into the spear, taking it deeper into himself, and stabs Mordred in the chest, killing him in seconds. It's such an awesome death scene that you'd wonder why they didn't do it in the book. In the book, Mordred was the one who got stabbed with a spear and gave Arthur a killing blow in return. But cheap effects aside, the movie's idea does work better. Now Arthur looks like the hero with the undying will, and Mordred gets a just punishment. So Arthur lays dying, surrounded by the corpses of his enemies and knights. He turns to Percival and gives him one last order.
Take Excalibur. Find a pool of calm water.
Throw the sword into it.
So Percival takes the sword to a nearby lake and does not throw it in. He actually returns to Arthur, lies about tossing the sword in, then pleads with the king, explaining that they might need it in the future.
My king, I couldn't do it. Excalibur cannot be lost. Other men...
Do as I command. One day, a king will come, and the sword will rise again.
Now, Percival didn't handle this in the book. He was dead, remember? Rather, Sir Bedivere had to lob the sword into the water. But we don't have time to introduce a new character, and if God's favorite Gary Stu isn't here, then we can skip Bedivere. While the event happened in the book, Percival was one of the chaste knights, which was why he was able to look upon the Holy Grail. Bedivere was just some extra who was readily available. But Percival returns once more, tosses Excalibur into the lake, where it's claimed by the Lady of the Lake. Percival returns to look for Arthur, but he's been loaded onto a boat, which sets sail for the mystical island of Avalon, where he might be healed and kept ready to return for England, should she ever need him again. Except for in the book, in which he gets buried in an unmarked grave. Now we just need Dan Brown to write a book about finding his burial site. Hey, Danny boy, call me, I got ideas. There's a lot to say about a movie this massive. A lot of effort went into making it, and that shows in almost every scene. Though some of that effort was a little misguided. Merlin was an oddball, but an enjoyable one. The fight scenes were usually lackluster, especially for viewers raised on CG-heavy fights. And while I couldn't really show it, there were times when the editing was awkward or nonsensical. The movie really hasn't aged well, and I'm not sure how much a modern audience might like it, but there is still fun to be had if you let it. Especially if you like classic stories like Arthurian legends. Flawed but fun, the movie gets a 3 out of 5. The book makes for an interesting study, since the writing style actually changes throughout the different chapters. When it starts out, it reads like its very own SparkNotes summary. Sentences are reduced to the most basic, substantive versions that they can be, so much so that glancing over a single sentence means the reader loses vital context. This changes later as dialogue becomes more prevalent, and more descriptions are given throughout conversation. The prose stays pretty dense throughout though, so readers with short attention spans might struggle a little. But fans of historical texts and old classic stories will love it. The pacing remains chaotic throughout the entire book though, so it helps if you're used to reading older classics. If I had a modern book written in the same style, I would definitely hate it. But since this one's a classic, it gets the pretentious older text protection that we literary snobs assign things. Which is the only way anyone can defend James Joyce, but that's another topic. If the older text is too difficult, then try an abridged version like the Kevin Baynes classical rendition. If you're curious about the stories, but don't want to get bogged down with a study session, I'd recommend this version. The stories are varied, breathtaking, and highly entertaining. The book gets a 4 out of 5. The movie did a lot to capture scenes from the book, but with something this dense, a lot is going to get cut. Arthur's campaign against the Roman Emperor, Tristram and Isolde's story, and many, many, many stories about the knights were all cut. But it would be unreasonable to assume the movie could keep all of the stories in place, since that would make the runtime over 10 hours. The elements that remained were heavily modified, but kept in line with the original mythos. What we get feels like an Arthurian legend, with maybe a few liberties taken here and there. The pacing of the movie was kind of an annoyance, thanks mostly to the editing. While some scenes evolved naturally, others cut in and out at awkward times or in odd ways. This was distracting the first time I saw the movie, but after reading the book, it kind of captures the erratic pace of the text. I don't think this was really intentional, so much as the result of preserving as much of the movie as possible, but it does kind of work, if only by coincidence. Either way, the movie is definitely a lot more fun after you've read the book, since you can pick up on the little details that Boorman was able to leave in. As an adaptation, Excalibur gets a 3 out of 5.
Thank you. You're going to wear a hole in your carpet. He should have been back by now. I'm sure he's fine.
You didn't see Strife. You don't know what he's like.
From my understanding, you only fought him the one time. I don't think you're an expert.
Yeah, well, he didn't leave you for dead.
You saw how he was equipped. He'll be fine.
I should have gone instead.
Okay. I'm not used to playing nursemaid, so I'm only going to say this the one time before I shoot you in the leg. He's fine. Shut your gob.
Fine. I'm just going to go read a book.
Dumb shite. Hey. Took your sweet time, did you?
Oh, yeah, sorry. Some of the hills were harder to walk through than I thought. Oh, finally. Did you find anything?
Well, I found Strife. He's hiding in a cabin in the mountains.
Good. All right, so I'll rush in an attack. You stay outside and cover me in case he tries to run.
There's one problem.
Okay, what?
It's the lock he uses on his door. It looks like magic.
Of course it is. I'll call GC. Hopefully he has some way to counter it. What kind of lock are we talking about?
It was this one stone by the door with a few runes on it.
How did you get close enough to see any runes?
Oh, Strife left for a while, so I...
You ran up to the building?!
Let's hope there weren't any cameras there.
No, I used my scope. Come on, I know what I'm doing. Besides, it's what you guys sent me there for.
Oh, you're the best man for the job, remember?
Whatever. Did you at least copy the runes before you left?
Yeah, that's a perimeter locking artifact, all right. Try to break in, you sound an alarm.
Oh, that's it?
Also, you blow up. Well, someone's paranoid.
Of course. So, how do we break in?
Just real quick. Is this going to be another one of your near-suicidal missions again?
Probably.
And you're going to ignore me, even if I tell you not to go?
Yep.
Of course you are.
So, how do I break in?
Well, these artifacts don't use traditional keys, per se. You'll need to press a keystone that's been encoded with a recording of something very specific.
So, it's like using a flash drive with some special coding software written on it to access a mainframe somewhere, right?
Yeah, something like that.
So then, what do I need to do? Like 100 jumping jacks?
Right idea, and potentially very entertaining, but that's the wrong key in this situation. No, according to this, you have to... Oh, ew!
What?
You're not gonna like this one.
Whatever. If it gets me my sword back, I'll do it.
You need to review a certain movie.
That's it? I already do that all the time. What's the movie?
Look, dude, this may sound like a joke, but I swear it's real. I mean, I'm sadistic, but this is just wrong.
GC... Quit stalling. What's the movie?
GC,
what's the movie?